So, hello, my name is Pauline Cordiner, and I'm going to tell you a couple of wee stories from where we are today, Boddam, in the northeast of Scotland. So, Cordiner, my second name, there's a bit of family folklore about where the name came from. So the story says that our ancestors came from Cordova in Spain, and they came up in a boat in a big ship in the 1600s, which was wrecked off the Skerry Rock just north of here. Whether that's true or not, I don't know, but we Cordiners do like our wee story that we're all actually a wee bit exotic and that we're from Spain. Now, when I was doing my family history research, I found a few nice wee stories, and one of them is about a man called Robert Cordiner, one of the many Robert Cordiners that lived in Peterhead in the 1890s, and his tea name was Bob Ridley. Now, a tea name is simply a nickname given to a person or even his line, his family, just to tell one Robert Cordiner from the next, one Alexander Stephen for the next. Now, Bob Ridley Cordiner, he was out in the bay in his fishing boat, and there was four of them aboard the boat. There was him, there was Scavvy, that's the lad's tea name, and another couple of guys. Two guys were down below, Bob Ridley and Scavvy were up on board, when all of a sudden Scavvy starts saying, "Bob, Bob, come here, come here." And they looked over the side of the boat, and the sea was boiling. There was a great creature beneath there, and they looked and looked, but they couldn't figure out what it was. But then it started to emerge from the water, and the beast was huge. It rose up from the water, and it put one forearm at one side, at the fore, and one forearm at the aft, and pushed down on the gunwale, and they knew that this was at least a distance of 30 feet. And then the creature used the movement of pushing down the boat to rise out of the water. They said that the boat rose out on the other side by up to three planks. So this was an enormous beast. And Bob Ridley started to climb up the mast. Now, whether this was to get a better look or whether this was out of fear to get away from the creature, we don't know. But then he gave the following description, because he was now 20 feet up the mast and this creature was still rising out of the water. It was said that its head looked like that of a giraffe, long-necked, and the mouth was big enough to swallow the Boddam omnibus. Its mouth was full of two rows of perfect white, sharp teeth, and its body was covered in patches of black and white hair-like substance. The man that was up the mast quickly shimmied down when he saw that this creature was still rising, taller than him, and he hid in the hold, grabbing hold of the other one and pulling them in. And in the hold was where the four men sheltered until the boat rocked back into place and they came out to see the creature disappearing back beneath the waves. Now, the local newspapers at the time, to me, sea monsters, when I first started looking into this, it was a bit "here be dragons." But no, this was 1892. This was the year when viruses were first reported by scientists. And the newspapers, they're full of stories like this. And they do take on a sort of scientific slant. Some of them wanted to know, was it the Kraken? Was it a sea serpent? Was it the Leviathan? I don't suppose we'll ever know. Other newspapers were a little bit more scathing and did think it was a great tale that had been made up by these four fishermen. They weren't likely to be drinkers, they were quite religious, many people on the northeast coast were. So there you are, there's the first story from my Cordiner ancestors, the story of the Boddam sea serpent. My father's father's name was James Cordiner, and he started his work in life quarrying granite just over there at Stirling Quarry. After the First World War, he moved to Aberdeen and became a monumental stonemason working in a workshop on Constitution Street. Now, according to my father, sometimes he would come back from a job
only to find that his workmates had made a wee monkey out of rope. And they'd put a noose around its neck and they had hung it above his work desk. If he wasn't in a good mood that day, he would rip it down and throw it into the brazier. You see, he hated it. He hated the way that folk would hear that he was from Boddam and shout after him, "Fa' hang it the monkey! Fa' hang it the monkey!" The Boddamers hung the monkey, oh. Although there are various different versions of this story all the way around the UK coast, famously in Hartlepool, but also off the coast, somewhere in Wales, somewhere in Cornwall, in Greenock, even there's a version from up in Cullen. In most versions of those stories, there's a ship is wrecked and the people find the monkey on board the boat dressed in a sailor's uniform and they mistake it for a Frenchman. Have I heard of that? We've been speaking to French folk for centuries. Nobody's going to fall for that. Our version of the story is nae so good. My father did suggest that the Boddamers thought that the monkey was the devil. But no, it doesn't ring true. This is the version that rings true to me. The story is set in the 1760s. A terrible, terrible storm had risen off the coast. The sky was black. The sea was that steel grey and the wind was howling and the rain was battering. The Boddamers weren't out in this. They weren't out in their fishing boats in this. They were safely in their houses. But nevertheless, over the sound of the wind and the sound of the waves, they could still hear that creaking, that crunching, the splintering of the boat which came aground on the scary rocks. For this was many years before they built Buchanness Lighthouse. When the storm abated, the Boddamers came out trying to see if anybody had survived the storm. Bodies, drowned bodies, were everywhere. But that did mean that there was a chance that they could loot whatever was on board the ship. You see, according to Scots law, as long as there was not a living soul on board that ship, then they could plunder anything that was there. But unfortunately, because of this law, ship's captains would take other creatures on board. Cats, famous for having nine lives. Parrots, a bird which will survive by flying off but will always return to its home, to the ship. And in this case, the ship was carrying a monkey. A monkey which had climbed the post. The monkey had survived the storm and the wreck, but it didn't survive the Boddamers. Times were tough in this wee fishing village. Money was hard to come by. They wanted what was on board that ship, so they beckoned for the monkey to come down. And so it was that the Boddamers hung the monkey, oh. Even to today, people don't like that story being told. So I think I'd better keep my voice down. Oh, the boat came round the coast, and a' the men on her was lost. Barring the monkey that climbed the post, so the Boddamers hung the monkey, oh. Dar-ma-do-a-do-a-day, dar-ma-do-a-daddy-o, dar-ma-do-a-do-a-day, and the Boddamers hung the monkey, oh. Well, a manny up to the monkey goes, he says, "Tak him awa' and awa' he goes." But the monkey leapt down and he bit off his nose. So the Boddamers hung the monkey, oh. Dar-ma-do-a-do-a-day, dar-ma-do-a-daddy-o, dar-ma-do-a-do-a-day, and the Boddamers hung the monkey, oh. Well, the funeral was a grand affair, and now the Boddam folk were there. It minded me of the Glasgow Fair, from the Boddamers hung the monkey, oh. Dar-ma-do-a-do-a-day, dar-ma-do-a-daddy-o, dar-ma-do-a-do-a-day, and the Boddamers hung the monkey, oh. Well, a' the folk fae Peterhead came doon expecting to get a feed. that they got was potted monkey heat. From the Boddamers hang the monkey, oh. Durum-a-do-a-do-a-day, durum-a-do-a-daddy-o. Durum-a-do-a-do-a-day, and the Boddamers hang the monkey, oh.